Welcome, y'all. It's Wes with DIY Food Plot Pro. Thank you so much for joining us. Today's episode, we're talking about how to have the best chance at killing your target buck early in the season. This is something that we as food plotters, as hunters, as land managers have to be aware of, is what food sources are the whitetails turning to and what sources are they turning off of. As we get closer and closer to season, our season actually opens tomorrow. We've got a gigantic cold front coming. It's going to be in the mid-40s Sunday morning here, and it's unbelievable how cold it's going to be for early September like it is. A lot of our bucks are shedding right now, and a lot of them still are holding on to that velvet pattern. Most all of them are still in their groups. But we are beginning to see one or two new ones coming to the farms. That tells me that the bachelor groups are starting to disperse and are starting to switch their fall ranges. I wanted to make this video because I know a lot of seasons are getting ready to come in. What's the best way to kill these mature bucks early in the season before the pressure gets on, well before the rut, well before the Orange Army shows up? My name's Wes. I run the channel DIY Food Plot Pro. I've got a Bachelor of Science in Agronomy. I farm for a living, and I've got a 2,900 acre whitetail deer hunting outfitter in Western Kentucky where we cannot pate. So we rely heavily on the food plots and the natural food to hunt the mature bucks that we're blessed to hunt here in Western Kentucky. What a difference 1 year makes. Last year, this oak flat, this is primarily a white oak flat, few red oaks out there, but primarily a white oak flat here. This was absolutely littered with white oak acorns. And we had what they call a masting year. It was a tremendous amount of white oaks where I've never seen as many as what was last year. You put your foot on the ground and you would guaranteed to be stepping on six or eight of them. Matter of fact, there was so many that a lot of these have not even been ate from last fall. They're still, of course, they're rotted by now, but there's a pile of them that are still here from last year. We had a good generation of young white oaks that grew this spring. So that's a good thing to be able to start another generation of white oaks on the farm. The reason for the video is how and what are our best chances of killing these mature bucks early in the season before the rut gets here. When we're looking at any source of early season hunting, food is always something that we're wanting to key in on. For our area, like I mentioned, white oaks are non-existent this year. The acorns are. So hunting in a white oak flat is not going to be my best option unless I'm hunting a travel route, okay? But hunting in here as far as the food source goes is going to be non-existent. So what are we looking at if we're not in the woods hunting the white oak acorns? A lot of the soybeans around here are being devastated by this drought that we've had for about a month. They have turned yellow. A lot of them are drying up. That food source is leaving, which is really uncommon for our area. Typically, the soybeans will continue going for at least another month, and then the frost typically gets them at that point. So the soybeans are kind of out at this point. This makes something kind of an odd type of environment for this year. The clovers that we have are burned up. The perennial clover plots that we have are completely burned up from this drought as well. The alfalfa is still hanging on, it's still doing okay, but it's not doing wonderful either. So there are a lot of deer feeding in the alfalfa. That would be a spot that I would want to be hunting if I was trying to hunt this time of the year. But the other thing that is a major limiting factor right now in a lot of part of the country, not just here in Western Kentucky, is water. And I know when we think of water hunting, we're thinking more like the Africa environments where it's extremely dry. There's only a small water source. But the reality of it is that's kind of the environment that we're living in right now. So I've got two or three cameras that pretty much stay on water sources. Now, they don't actually show the water source, but they show a trail that leads to a creek. And it's got a really deep hole where it makes a turn. Okay, so the hole is really, really deep right there, and it never runs out of water. And it's about the only place in the creek for probably a mile either way that has water. So when it gets dry, those whitetails really utilize that water, and they really hammer that. I do a lot of consulting during the wintertime months, and I get asked a ton about water holes. Wes, what do you think about water holes? And a lot of folks kind of have this kind of backwards in their brain that they think water holes are for, it would be for us, right? We're going to drink a ton of water when it's 100 degrees outside. That's going to be when we're drinking the most water. But for whitetails, it's kind of the exact opposite. In the summertime, typically, there's enough moisture in that plant, right? So a soybean plant, take for example, will be running 70, 80% moisture. When it dries down this time of the year, our soybeans, when we get ready to harvest them, they'll be running 13% moisture. What a significant drop that is from what it was just 2-3 weeks ago. Same way with corn. Corn will be running 80-85% moisture, and then we start harvesting it somewhere around the 15 to 12 range is what we're looking for in corn. We're losing a lot of our moisture that the deer are feeding on these plots. No matter what it is, as it starts to dry down, it's losing moisture, and at that point, the whitetails aren't getting as much moisture off of that. The fall and wintertime months are when whitetails are really seeking out that water anyway. So it kind of sets up a perfect storm for this early part of the season as we have a lot of dry spells going on right now throughout the entire United States. The crops are drying down. The food plots are dry because they're not getting as much rain, so they're not nearly as high moisture content as what they were a month ago. It makes water sources even better to hunt over. We started getting into this drought. That camera that was looking at the water source trail pretty much all summer, we had plentiful rain, so we really didn't have a stretch to where a lot of deer were using that. And that's where I planted the release system, and I was really kind of starting to make me mad because this is the first year that I've not seen a tremendous amount of velvet bucks in that area. I was starting to wonder, is it just the food source? Because I've had that there for 3 years and I've had a pile of velvet bucks there every single year. It's the first year that I have not. But as this weather started to dry down, I've started to notice a significant uptick in the amount of bucks, specifically bucks for some reason, are coming to that trail to go get water. So water and food are two huge things to look for in this early part of the season, especially when you're in dry parts of the country. So this drought's been a disaster for fall food plots. It's been a disaster for a lot of us, for farmers. But one thing that it does, it really makes this a little bit easier, kind of draws us down. It's kind of like that one white oak tree in the middle of the woods that's dropping acorns and none of the rest of them are, right? Because all our corn's drying down. And we know that when the corn starts drying down, the deer aren't going to eat it until it gets pretty much dry. At that point, they'll start eating it again. But as it's starting to dry down, as that color's changing from green to yellow, the deer stop eating it. The same way with these soybeans, it's the exact same thing. When they're green, deer are going to absolutely hammer them. As they start turning to yellow, we start seeing that drop in the deer eating those plots, eating those soybeans. It makes our job a little harder, but a little easier at the same time. We have to get out and we have to scout and we have to find those summer food sources that are still available, that are still dark green, that the whitetails are keying in on. Because there's no question, right now, a whitetail's diet is still protein. The whitetail diet has not switched to the high carbs yet that it will here in the next month or so. We are still in our protein diet. Find something that is good and dark green, we are going to find a lot of deer utilizing that plot, that crop field, whatever it may be. So in my case, what we have kind of set up is the ridges are burned up. They've been burned up for a while. We've had 100 degree heat and about a month or so of no rain or no significant rain. We've got a bottom field, and the river bottom field is still holding pretty decent moisture. It obviously has struggles with getting rid of the moisture in the spring and early summer, but this is when those bottom fields really start to shine, is when we get into a significant drought like we are right now. I'll show you some pictures of the differences between the ridge fields that are completely 100% burned up and are just ruined, and the bottom field that is doing really, really, really good. And I guarantee you there is a ton of browse pressure on that food plot down there because that's the only food source available to those whitetails right now. So to be successful in this early hunting season, we've got to figure out the food sources that the whitetails are using. And sometimes that takes a little scouting, going around in your woods. Your conditions will be different than mine. Maybe you do have some white oaks dropping. Maybe you do have some red oaks that are beginning to drop, things like that, that you may need to key in on. Maybe you have some crop fields like me that are burned up, but you also have a crop field down in a little, you know, a little bottom or a little food plot down in a bottom where the soil's a little bit deeper, a little wetter soil, that the food plots are doing significantly better. And those are areas that you key in on during this early part of the season. And we'll be keying in on those for about another month or so as we transition into this pre-rut phase that we're fixing to go into. We'll have another video explaining where we're setting up for those type areas, what we're looking for in those areas to be able to harvest those deer pre-rut before the Orange Army shows up for those as well. So thank you guys so much for watching. I really appreciate it. Y'all smash that like and subscribe button.